refrigerator side before me.
Yeah, glory.
Could I ask everybody to bow their heads? Open up your hearts. All minds open. Father, I thank you today once again for this privilege of being able to stand before your people to proclaim that there is none like you, that you are the Alpha and the Omega, that you are the beginning and the end, that you have been, that you are, that you always will be the author and the finisher of our faith. Have your way right now, Holy Spirit. Speak to your people, God. Thank you for the blood that in spite of what I've done and who I've been, that it was your blood that purged and prepared me even now. So, Master, as I hide behind the cross, and as I cling therein, I beseech you once again, God, that the words of my mouth, that the meditation of my heart be acceptable only in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let the people of God say amen,
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 and amen.
Amen.
Praise. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Well, we are on our final lesson of this journey. How many of you have been blessed thus far
amen.
On this journey?
Amen.
And we have been dealing with and talking about, vital signs of a healthy church.
Wow.
Amen. The vital signs of a healthy church. Our hope is that there's still some up and down. If it's going up and down, Charlotte, that means still alive. Somebody talk to me. Amen. How many of us know if you're alive, some days are up and some are not as up as others? Somebody talk to me. What we don't want to see, Reverend Rice, we don't want to see no flat line. Somebody talk to me. Amen. I don't want it to be business as usual. I don't want the flat line.
Yeah.
I want every day. How many of us know his mercies are new every morning? Amen. So, amen. We don't want no flat line. We want to see some movement. Amen. Every day may not be a peak, Brother Charleston, but I'm grateful. How many of us grateful for some valley days?
Amen.
Glory.
And amen. We need to learn that our valley days is when God does his best work, Jane.
Amen.
So we are thankful about all that God. So today is going to be the final part of this journey, talking about the vital signs of a healthy church. Amen. S-I-G-N-S. So the last one we're going to deal with today, the S portion of it, is going to deal with outwardly focused. If you are a healthy church, and how many of us know where the real church is? The real church is where? Turn to somebody and say, I'm the church. Amen. I'm the church. We are the real church. And so today, as we end this journey, I want to share and I want to teach and talk about today, Leo, that one vital sign or one characteristic of a healthy church is that a healthy church is outwardly focused.
Well,
amen. Turn to somebody and say, it's not about me.
It's not about me.
So a healthy church is outwardly focused. Amen. And that means that all members, that the whole body, everybody in the body of Christ is committed and involved, amen, in outreach and in evangelism and in mission. Turn to somebody and tell them, I got a mission.
I got a mission.
Amen. We all should be and we must be involved in the mission work of Christ. Thank you, the elder who read the scripture for today out of Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Amen. We're going to deal with that a little bit. today, amen. The Matthew writer was very clear, the command of Christ. Everybody say the Great Commission.
Great Commission.
Amen. I'm going to teach my way out of this today, so you may not do no cartwheels or nothing. We're going to just teach our way out of this thing. And so the Matthew writer said that, amen, we have a great commission to go out and preach the gospel, and that we are to teach them to observe all things that Christ has commanded for us to do, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit of God. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
In conjunction with this text, if you would turn in your Bibles, I'm going to read from the book of Luke. In the 14th chapter, verses 16 through 22, Luke in the 14th chapter, verses 16 through 22, you don't have to stand again, but follow along with me as we read. Luke writes these words, 14 and 16. Then said he unto him, a certain man made a great supper, and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. Turn to somebody and say, there it is. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and showed his Lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor, and the maimed, and the halt, and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. May God be a blessing to the reading and hearing of this anointed word, and may I today have the courage to teach it. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
With the Spirit of God's help today, as we descend from this journey, I want to use for a primary teaching thought. I want to use for a primary teaching thing called a topic today, bringing in the sheep. I want to talk about today, bringing in the sheep. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Bringing in the sheep. Turn to somebody and say, we got work to do.
We got work to do.
Amen. We got work to do.
We got work to do.
Say, bringing in the sheep. Amen. Praise be to God. Bringing in the sheep. As a subthought, write this down. There's a subtitle I'm going to use today as a subtitle. Are you ready for the real church? Are you ready for the real church?
Yeah.
Amen. We say we're ready. But we're going to find out. Are we ready, Minister Nelly, for the real church?
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
From our first text, John MacArthur, great theologian, points out there's only one verb in that whole sentence, one major verb in the original scripture that was written. It's the verb make disciples. The word going, the word baptizing, the word teaching are participles that modify the one main verb in this scripture. We must understand that the responsibility of the church in the world is to go out and to make disciples. In this passage, the verb is the second person plural, which means you disciple. First eros tense, imperative mood, which signifies instantaneous action. When God speaks, we all move.
Amen.
Or something to be undertaken at once. You do it now. In the scripture, it's an active voice, indicating ongoing action. We must understand that as you're going about your interactions, we must understand that God is actively speaking to us and expecting us to act with a sense of urgency. So what are you saying? I'm saying that in these latter days, we have no time to be lazy, negligent, or in error as to what God has told us to do. We must have a sense of urgency that at every point and at every moment, Sister Esther, there's a sense of urgency. There ought to be something inside of us that creates a sense of urgency that even when I come into the presence of someone in the grocery line that is struggling, something ought to unction me to start praying. Are you hearing me? The main point in the Great Commission is to make disciples of all nations. In our second passage today, we will find Jesus teaching a parable. A parable is an earthly story, amen, that teaches us a heavenly truth. Earthly story. A king had decided to throw a banquet and invited all of his closest friends to the banquet. The parable explains that all of the invited guests decided other things were more important. Turn to somebody and say, he's going someplace.
He's going somewhere.
They decided that other things were more important than attending the banquet. As such, the host invites complete strangers who gladly accepts his invitation. We have Bible study on Wednesday night.
Mm-hmm. That was good too.
Prayer on Tuesday. Men's meeting on Saturday. Women's meeting on Thursday. Food bank on Monday. Usher's meeting on Saturday. Praise and worship on Thursday. And yet, those who should be there are not always there. What are you saying? Jeff, I'm saying that there ought to be a sense of urgency.
Amen.
That we ought to be where we should be.
Amen.
When we should be there.
Amen.
The invitation has been extended. And we're going to deal with it. I'm going to give you the punchline and then I'm going to build back up to it, Mother Harriet. The scripture says in Revelation, let whosoever will. See, the wonderful thing is that God makes his word plain enough and generic enough that if you really want to, you can put yourself in the word. Turn to somebody and ask them, where you at? So the scripture says, whosoever will, let him come and drink freely. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Heavenly truth. The Jews rejected the invitation of the kingdom of God. And as such, God offered it to the Gentiles as well, who gladly showed up. We are called to make an impact or difference in our world. We are not called to just exist in the world. When Jesus told the parable of the laborers being sent into the harvest, those standing around late in the day were asked, why are you just standing around here? Go out and do something.
Right. Amen.
The question is today, Brother David, how many of us are hearing the voice of God asking us the question, why are you doing nothing?
Wow.
Why are you just standing around and doing nothing?
My.
The scripture declares the harvest is
plentiful.
This is call and response. Let me try that again. The scripture says that the harvest is
plentiful,
but the laborers are
few.
And so the question is today, there's plenty enough work to do. Why are you not working? In our text, it is customary to send two invitations to the party. The first to announce the party, and then the second one to tell the guest that the party is ready.
Yeah.
Amen.
The guest in Jesus' story insulted the host by making excuses when he issued the second invitation. In Israel's history, God's first invitation came by way of Moses and the prophets.
All right.
The second came through his son, Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
The religious leaders, watch this, the religious leaders accepted the first invitation. They had believed God had called them to be his leaders, but they insulted God by refusing to accept his son, Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
So they accepted that God was God, but yet they were not able to accept that Christ was the Son of God. Christ said, you seen me, what? You seen the Father. Said, me and my Father are one. So they could accept the Father, but they could not accept the fact that Christ had come and was God in the flesh. The host, watch this, the host is outraged over these rejections. But he turned his anger to grace. See, we have to understand that God will never allow food to go to waste.
Amen. Amen.
God will never allow food to go to waste. So if you won't eat it, so he chooses, watch this, he chooses an unexpected option.
Uh-huh.
He tells his servant to invite the outcasts. Not the beautiful people, but the so-called unwashed masses.
Mm.
Who offer no excuses. These are the kind of people Jesus were known to frequent from time to time.
All right.
Yeah.
Matters such as real estate, livestock didn't impede them from coming to the meal. And many of them couldn't even afford to be married.
All right.
They're told, come in. The table is set.
Mm-hmm.
They were welcomed by the host of hospitality. How many of us, God has extended us an invitation only to tell God, not now?
Mm-hmm.
Amen. How many of us have been extended an invitation, mother, by God, only to tell God, let me get back to you?
Mm-hmm.
How many of us have been extended an invitation only to tell God, I wish I could?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody talk to me. Yeah, we're going to end this thing right. How many of us, God has extended us an invitation, but we tell God, you know, if you would have just got to me early.
No.
Uh-huh.
Help us, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Three things. Write it down. Number one. Number one. Rejection should not be a surprise in evangelism.
Uh-huh.
Tell somebody, say, don't be shy.
Don't be shy.
Do you show it like this? Say, don't be shy.
Don't be shy.
Don't be surprised.
Don't be surprised.
When you try to reach out, when you try to do the work of God, when you try to rise to do what God has called you to do, turn to somebody and say, don't be shy.
Don't be shy.
It is not a surprise that when you try to share the good news, share the gospel, try to win a soul, try to let somebody know that God loved me right where you are, that God forgave me like he'll forgive you, that there's still a chance, still an opportunity. How many of us will know that somebody say, talk to the hand? So you see the young woman there saying, And how many of us have tried to witness to somebody, or how many of us have been afraid of rejection, and so we don't do what God calls us to do because we think we're going to get rejected. See, we make it up in our own mind, Brother Hunter, that I'm not going to be accepted. And so what happens is that I choose not to do nothing because I don't want to experience rejection. So that generally is what really happens. Cynthia, it's easier for me not to do anything because if I don't do anything, Marie, then I don't have to feel rejection.
Amen.
Somebody talk to me. Turn to somebody and tell them, don't be surprised.
Don't be surprised.
In Matthew, the 15th chapter, verse number 8, and this is in both New Testament and Old Testament. I want to walk you through right now. Matthew, the 15th chapter, verse number 8, and look at what it said. It said, "This people draw nigh unto me with their mouth."
Amen.
Is that what it said? Everybody shout lip service.
Lip service.
Come on, everybody get a corporate stop. Shout lip service.
Lip service.
So he said, "With their mouth they do honor me, and with their lips, but their hearts are far from thee." In the New Testament, stay there. In the Old Testament, rather, in the book of Isaiah 29:13, write it down. It said, "Wherefore the Lord said, for as much as this people draw nigh me with their mouth, with their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear towards me is taught by the precepts of man." So both the Old Testament and in the New Testament, it records that the same issue is the same issue. And I'm here to tell you that the same issue is the same issue today.
Amen.
That a lot of people give God lip service. So we're going to get beyond making it personal today because the enemy make you get lost there. Well, it ain't about you. You're right. But the same way you do your brother and your sister, the same way you do God. We give God, Kenny, a lot of lip service. But when it comes down to living what we say, we find that our hearts are really not in it. Somebody talk to me.
Amen.
2 Timothy 3 and 5, write it down. We're going to walk right through this thing. 2 Timothy 3 and 5. Paul, writing to his son Timothy, said these words. He said, "Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away."
Right. Well.
Now, here is what I'm not suggesting. What I'm not suggesting is that we cut folks off. Because the reality is that everybody from this place to that place, from that place to over there, all of us have issues.
Yeah.
Amen.
There you go.
And every last one of us ought to be able to thank God, Mother Audrey, that we're at something.
Oh,
yeah. That should make somebody
happy. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
But with that reality, we must understand that in these latter days, that a lot of folks are acting the part, but their hearts really are not in it. One of the things that I've talked about for a number of years, and I'm not going to overly spend a lot of time on it, Charlene, but one of the things that I've experienced in 22 years is that there's a spirit of what is called passive aggressiveness. Many of you may know what that is, Reverend Rice, passive aggressiveness. Leo, I agree with you, but my actions demonstrate that I didn't really mean what I said.
All right.
So I do something different.
We many times will say that we agree. We many times will say we understand. We many times will say we support. But when our actions manifest, what happens is, Sister Esther, it is the total contrary to what I say. So I tell you, since I got your back. That's what he says, since I got your back. The only word, I got your back. But then when you go take off walking, you get about 4 or 5 steps, and all of a sudden you start hearing silence.
Help us, Lord.
And then you wonder why, because when you started out, Mother, you were hearing sets of footprints moving. Somebody will get that. But then when you get about 5 or 6 steps down the road, all of a sudden, it starts now sounding like I just hear myself walking. The Bible said, how can two walk together? Is this making sense? How can two walk together, Mr. Melanie, except they agree? We can't say that we agree with our words. We have to agree in the Spirit.
All right. Come on, Bishop.
Because the Spirit will hold us accountable.
Yes.
The Spirit will hold us in unity.
Yes.
Are you hearing me?
Amen.
Watch this. Number 2, write it down. Because I know we want to get to that Super Bowl game. Number 2. Write down, number 2. When it happens, and turn to somebody and say, it's going to happen. When it happens, report back to the master and then wait for instruction. Turn to somebody and say, it's going to happen.
It's
going to
happen.
Regina, it's going, not maybe, it's not a good possibility. I'm here to tell you it's going to happen. But what I want you to know today is that when it happens, don't get on the phone and call nobody. Turn to somebody and say, the phone ministry is dead. Don't pick up the phone and call nobody. What you do is you talk to God. The songwriter said, just a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about your
trouble.
He'll hear your faintest cry. And answer what? I can feel God's mind. I need some old things in here right now. Because I can feel the prayer well turned.
Yes.
That's
right. Come on now.
Make it all right. All right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. All right.
Not at all.
Come on, right?
Tell the master. Mm-hmm. When they blow you off, tell the master. When they won't hear you, tell the master.
That's it.
When they reject you, tell the master. When they talk about you, tell the master. When they try to treat you as insignificant, tell the master. When they don't include you, tell the master. When they didn't call you, tell the master. When they don't show up, tell the master. I can feel it, bro. Do I have a witness in that?
Yes.
Write the scripture down. 1 John 5. 1 John 5. Verses 14 through 16 says, if any man see his brother sin a sin, or 1 John 5, 16, if any man see his brother sin a sin, which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. There is a sin unto death, and I do not say that he shall pray for it. So we have to learn how to hate the sin.
Right.
and love the sinner. Let's say that again. What we have to learn how to do is we have to learn how to hate the sin and love the sinner. What we typically do is we will hate the sinner and then turn around and do the sin.
Help us, Lord.
I'm going to say it again. What we many times will do is we will hate the sinner and then we will turn around and do the sin. Because the reality of it is that we have become experts at being able to point out everybody else's stuff. We are extremely proficient at pointing out somebody else's deficiency. But the Bible says, let a man first. I should have had three people who should have shouted praise God right there.
Praise God.
The Bible said, let a man first examine himself. See, I've got enough work in my own baby to do. I can't even get to your stuff. I got enough stuff of my own. Somebody be real with me today. I got enough stuff of my own, certainly, that I don't have no time to go with nothing that you do. Let me remind you that we're all under construction here today. My walls are tore up. He just slashed all my wiring out. Somebody talk to me. He done gutted all the plumbing. But thanks be to God, he stole this through the plumbing. Anybody get this? Anybody grateful that God ain't gave up on you? That God is, tell somebody, just tell him he's still working on me. And I'm going to read this out of the New Living Translation. It felt a lot better. In St. John's the 15th chapter, verse number 18. I'm going to read it out of the New Living Translation because it just felt better. He said, if the world hates you, remember that it hated me first. We got to stop taking stuff so personal. You act like you're the first one that somebody didn't agree with. Somebody talked about the first one that somebody betrayed. You ain't the first one. Turn to somebody and tell them you ain't gonna be the last one. We must not take, we take stuff too personal. Put on your big girl pants, your big boy pants, and realize that you're not the first one to come under attack. And actually, if you read your Bible, watch this, pretty change my mouth. If you read ago, we said that we're no longer somebody we're going through. We said that now God is shaping us. How many of you can proclaim that God's got his hands on you? And that God is shaping you. And watch this, I'm going to see you again. Watch this. The scripture says, watch this, Elder. The scripture, Pastor Forrest said the other week, he said that the clay is in the hands of the potter. But then he turned around and said this, and he said that the very clay that's in the potter's hands is marred. And that made my spirit jump. He said, why, Bishop? Because I can be in God's hand and still have imperfection. And I can still be in the will of God and still have some flaws. And you need to stop letting the devil lie to you that just because you have issues, just because you got some flaws, just because you got some imperfections, that you don't belong to God. You still in God's hand. God still has his hands on you. You might come on shame the devil. Just because I got some flaws, somebody talk to God with me.
Said Jeff, it's time to come home now.
Somebody talk to me. How many of us got a testimony that you were out in the wilderness? See, in the traditional sense, I want you to understand, in the traditional sense of evangelism, mission work, we have a responsibility to still go out into the hedges and the highways and to minister the gospel to those little who are lost, those who are poor and those who do not have, and those who are sleeping outside, those who are looking for their next meal. We have a responsibility. Yeah. The Bible said, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was sick, you came to see about me. It's time for the church of the living God to come out of these walls, and it's time for us to get out in the streets and do the real work of God. It's time for us to go to the bridges. It's time for us to go into the alleyways. It's time for us to go stand and have prayer vigils outside of crack houses and believe that one by one they will come out delivered and healed. Y'all ain't saying that, baby. See, we have the authority, Minister Melody, that we can go to the crack house and we can stand outside and we can encamp. Are you hearing me? That we can encamp around the encampment of the devil. The Bible said, writes that when the servant woke up and told his master that they were surrounded on every side, the Bible said that he prayed for him, and there appeared unto him an army behind the army. And I'm saying that we can be the army behind the army that can overtake the works of the devil. The numbers of the devil might be against us, and they appear that it's against us, but you can tell your own story that when everybody else threw you away, that's when God found you. How many of you have your own testimony that when somebody else threw you away, when the devil thought you were down and out, somebody introduced you to Jesus? Somebody, the song says, somebody prayed for me. We have to realize that the real church is in the hedges and the highways.
Yeah.
There's a real work that we have to do in the streets.
Yeah.
A real work that we have to do to those who are homeless, those who are transitioning in their life.
Yeah.
But there's also another work that we have to do.
Yeah.
And this work is not done in the streets. This work is done on Facebook, and on Twitter, and on Instagram, and it's done on Blogger. Somebody talk to me. This work is done to the millennials. Young adults who have lost all hope in the church. Young adults who have discovered and have found out and believe that the church has forgotten about them and has now deemed them irrelevant, unuseful, who now look back at the church and now feel that the church is not relevant anymore, that the church is not real, that they had enough, Minister Melanie, of hypocrisy. And that the time has come for them to say, I don't want any of them. And so now what has happened is that they've turned to alternative things, Marie, to satisfy them. And so now they're caught betwixt the flesh, which they know is real because they can get that instantaneous gratitude. And that which they really want and hope for, but they've lost hope in it because it has lost them. And so there's a new work that we have to do, and we have to reach out and we have to start going into the airways, and we got to meet them where they are, because they're talking on Facebook. And they're talking by way of Instagram. They're talking by way of network. And so what we have to do is we have to do the next work, the new work, and we have to meet them where they are. Somebody say praise God.
Praise God.
So we have to go after the millennials like never before. We have to get on Periscope. And we have to meet them where they are. Turn to the next. Technology has taken the place of the church.
Yeah.
The building.
Yeah.
Technology has replaced the building.
Yeah.
And so the question is, do we just settle for the fact that the building is no longer relevant, or do we still believe the work is real?
The work is real.
See, we have to be convinced that the work is still real, the work is still needed, that we still have a mandate, Cynthia, to meet them where they are. They're talking to each other.
Yeah.
It's time for us to get into the midst of the conversation.
Right.
Because here's the thing that I know. They might count the church building. They might count the church people, Minister Melody, irrelevant. They might treat them that way, but they ain't going to treat God as irrelevant.
That's right.
Because at the end of the day, what I know that I know that I know in my spirit is that they still fear God. Now, they may be acting in their flesh in the spirit of rebellion. They may be angry. They may not, they don't know how to work out their issues, Leo. Nobody's helping them work through their stuff. And so, because their stuff is real to them, they're acting in the spirit of rebellion. And here's the one thing that I've learned, and it's not just for our millennials, even though I'm focusing on them right now. What I've learned is that some people, many people, most people, even bad intention is attention.
Yeah, right.
Mm.
That's real.
Real talk,
that's good.
I'm learning that,
right?
I'm learning that some people need and want attention so bad that they will create bad intention. Bad. Because I'd rather have some attention than no attention. We got to learn to get out of Snapchat.
Yes.
And watch what people are posting on Snapchat. And we can't be afraid, Mother, to post on Snapchat.
That's right.
Now, we don't have to post all the nonsense that they're posting.
Right.
But what we ought to be doing, Rice, is when they're posting nonsense, that I would post sense.
Yes, sir.
Right. Yeah.
I'm going to try that again.
Yeah, that's good.
That when they post nonsense, that I have the authority to post sense.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't matter where they run into the truth. The question is, are we putting the truth where it needs to be?
Yes.
Amen. Oh, yeah. So I'm not worried about how many are going to go come and plop down in the church.
Right.
The question is, how many can we say? The Bible talks about not filling up the house.
Right.
The Bible talks about adding to the kingdom every day. And I want us to shift our thinking, Brother Jeff, and say, how many are being added to the kingdom every single day?
Amen.
All right.
And we need to stop, Rice, measuring the success of ministry by how many people plop down in the chair.
Yes, sir.
And we need to start looking at ministry as a, how many can we send out into the venue?
Amen.
And do the work that God has called. Are you hearing me today?
Yes, sir.
Write the scripture down. Psalms 113. Psalms 113, stanza number 7 and 8. Says he rises up the poor out of the dust and lifted the needy out of the dunghill, that he may set him with princes, even with princes of his people. Don't you know that God is getting ready to turn somebody's situation around?
Yeah. All right.
Amen.
In the way, watch it, the way he turns it around, Mother Audrey, is we have to learn how to tell our story.
Yeah.
All right.
See, when we talk about real evangelism is witnessing that God is good, and I know that he's good because he's been good in my life.
Yes.
You may not know how to quote scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, but you can tell your story. And the Bible writer says, and the New Testament says, that they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Don't you know that there's liberty in your testimony?
Yeah.
To let somebody know that I was a drunkard, but God cleaned me up.
Yes.
That I was an addict, but God cleaned me up.
Yes.
That the gun should have went off, but God spared my life. That I didn't have something to eat.
Yes, it is, Bishop.
And so we've got to do the traditional work that God has called us to do. Yes, to the homeless and those who are transitioning, Audrey, in their life. We have to do that traditional work. That's what he called us to do. That's the practical work that God has called us to. Write down 1 Samuel 2 and 8. In 1 Samuel 2 and 8, it says the same thing. It said, he rises up the poor out of the dust and lifted up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes and to make them inherit the throne of glory. Don't you know that the inheritance, Brother Charleston, is not just for you and I? The inheritance is for those who are out in the streets but still are trusting God. Even though they don't, remember what he told Thomas? He said, greater is the one who did not see it, but yet believed. There's a greater reward for somebody, mother, who is outside sleeping under the star. Wish they had a roof over their head, but to the very end, they believed that God would still be able to make a way. Because what was inside of them is that even though in their flesh they desired an earthly roof over their head, what was greater to them was the faith that in the Father's house.
Yes. Yes.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
James 2 and 5, write it down. James 2 and 5 says, hearken, my beloved brother.
Yes.
Hath not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom, which he hath promised to them that love him? There are folks who can't see it, but yet they believe that God is still in
them.
I said it this morning, I want to repeat it again. Now, I said it in Sunday school, that we have too many people who believe faith is about God giving me something. Instead of realizing that faith is trusting in the fact that God has already given me enough when he gave me Jesus. When he gave us Christ, he gave us more than enough. Somebody say praise God. Just a couple more scriptures, we'll be done. In Matthew 5 and 3, write it down. Matthew 5 and 3 says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. I want to again repeat that there's a lost generation. There's a hungry generation. A group of young adults who are misplaced. They're misguided because they've been mishandled.
I know.
Wow. And I will say that again. They've been misled. They've been misguided because they've been mishandled. You can't treat what God has given you any type of way.
Say it,
Bishop.
Say it.
Say it again.
You can't mistreat what God has given you.
Amen.
Every child, every young adult in this house ought to be treated as precious cargo.
Amen.
That's right.
Yes.
It's a shame before God the work that we're not doing.
Help us.
So, Mother, we can feel good about all the stuff we're doing. We can feel good about all the stuff that we're attaining. We can feel good about all the things that are happening. But shame on us that we will become complacent and satisfied and know that the greatest work is not being done.
Yeah.
He said, suffer the little children, for such is the kingdom. One of the greatest things that he said, except you come as a little child. Matter of fact, he said, I think so much about a child that you can't even get it unless you come as a child. And we have to ask ourselves, what work are we doing as it relates to children? What work are we doing as it relates to youth in our community? What work are we doing? I coach, and I'll end on this note, I coach football. Most of you know that I coach football over at Lincoln High School. And we have workout every morning at 5:30 in the morning at Lincoln. I went to workout on Thursday morning, Mother, and one of the young men came up to me and said, hey, Coach, after we're done with workout, can I talk to you for a minute? I said, absolutely.
And he came and talked to me, and he wanted to talk to me because he said he was struggling in his relationship with his girlfriend. But see, I told you all this, and I'm going to repeat it again now. Folks will talk to you about the surface stuff. And if you don't have discernment to be able to know that there's something more, you'll miss it entirely.
Every time.
And so I was able to discover, watch this, I was able to discover that what he was really facing was that his mother just got an evict notice. And that they were going to be out on the street in 3 days. And watch this. Not just the fact, Charlene, that the family was going to be out on the street in 3 days, but his mother told him, you need to find some place to live. You're not hearing me. How are you, watch this, and to show you how God allows the enemy to work, this is a boy who nearly has a 4.0 grade point average. So this is not some wayward kid. This is not some kid who is doing drugs and in trouble and being called to the principal's office, expelled him. This is a boy who is striving for excellent things in his life, believes that there's more for him to do, and yet the enemy is being allowed to attack him so that he's got on his mind, where am I going to lay my head?
Yeah.
Are you hearing me? Ask yourself, what are you focused on? When you really think about all the people who you come in contact with during the course of the day, Sister Esther, ask yourself, how many times, Lord, did you put me in the presence of someone who was going through something that's not evident from the outside? And that all it took was just a moment of attention and love. And it could have turned their situation around. Yeah. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Marie, how many times do we come in contact with somebody? Audrey, how many times do we come in contact with somebody in the context of what you do? Somebody who's a throwaway. Their family not coming to visit them. Nobody's coming to see about them. They're now at the mercy of a nursing home who is more concerned about the dollars and cents than they are taking care of their patients. And how many times do we come in contact with that person and forget that we still know how to pray?
Yeah. Right.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Write this down. Luke 14, 13, and 14. When thou make a feast, call the maimed and the lame and the blind, and thou shalt be blessed. For they cannot recompense thee. For thou shalt be recompensed at the resurrection of the just. Stop looking for your payment now. Stop looking for your payday now. And do it because you believe that your reward will come after a while. I want us to recognize that the church that God is looking for doesn't talk the way we talk.
Amen.
That the real church, mother, ain't going to look like we look.
Come on here.
That the real church is not going to think like we think.
Yeah.
The real church is not going to have the same interests that we do. But we have a responsibility, as Jesus did, to meet them where they are.
Amen.
Because the common denominator is Jesus. Now their flavor may be different, their style may be different, their swag may be different, their preference may be different, but right, the common denominator is still Jesus. And I want you to know that Jesus still works. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Every head bowed.